friends, thank you very much for all your views of my previous video and your share and also your comments. Thank you very much. And today, let's talk about the portability of your employees' provident fund contributions to national pension system, or also exercising the option of NPS in lieu of EPS. If you have heard the media news, this proposal is running from the last 2 to 3 years. However, you may not be aware whether it is possible to port your employees' provident fund accumulation to national pension system. But before we proceed on this topic in detail, we need to know certain basic information about national pension system. You may also know about a little bit about provident fund and also its contributions. We also need to know the comparison between NPS and also the EPF, the taxability and other specifics, if you have to talk about the portability. And also to decide whether you have to port or transfer your accumulations to NPS, you need to know this information. So let's proceed, friends. So before we get into the details or specifics about this topic, we need to know what is this NPS or National Pension Scheme. See, if you look at the National Pension Scheme details, this scheme is launched in the year 2004, January. And originally, it is only limited to government employees, and it is a government-sponsored pension scheme. However, in 2009, it was open to all sections of the society. And the scheme allows a subscriber to contribute regularly in a pension account during their working life. On retirement, subscribers can withdraw a part of the corpus in a lump sum and use the remaining corpus to buy an annuity to secure a regular income after the retirement. See, after the retirement, you will not have a regular income. So therefore, you need to make an arrangement for regular income. If you talk about employees provident fund, there is a pension scheme, and if you are eligible for a pension scheme, the provident fund continue to give certain pension amount. So whereas for people like, you know, other employees and people who are not in the EPF range, for them this system or this scheme is very beneficial. And this annuity is nothing but when you have certain contributed certain corpus, you can pay it to insurance company, and insurance company will agree to pay certain regular returns for a certain period of time. It depends on your choice. You can also get these returns for a lifetime or for a certain period of time. So it is depending upon the option you choose. And in NPS, what happens, you will have two kinds of account: tier 1 account and tier 2 account. Tier 1 is nothing but it is related to your pension fund, and you can continue to contribute, and withdrawal is subject to the guidelines or the provisions of the NPS scheme. And there is another kind of account which is called tier 2 account. This is basically, you know, like your investment option, like a mutual fund account. You can continue to contribute, and it will earn the returns as per the fund performance. And you also have a possibility to transfer the fund from NPS or the tier 2 account to tier 1 account. So this is the basic difference between tier 1 and tier 2 account. This proposal originally proposed in the year 2015 budget speech, and accordingly the Income Tax Act 1961 is also amended in 2016 to provide exemption from income tax from one-time portability, because when you port your accumulations to another fund, it can also be treated as income in the hands of the employee. Therefore, to avoid the situation, and there is a tax benefit or exemption is provided by way of an amendment in the year 2016. And there is an authority called PFRDA. See, this PFRDA is nothing but Pension Fund Regulatory and Development Authority. This is the nodal agency to regulate and also promote the pension sector in the country. And this authority, the National Pension Scheme or the system, is administered or regulated by this authority. And this authority on 6th March 2017 issued a circular and also clarified what are the steps you need to follow to transfer your accumulations from provident fund to the NPS system. And this is the circular, my dear friends, which I am referring about it. And this transfer facility is also provided for superannuation funds. You may have heard that many of the companies of the corporates have also called a fund called superannuation fund, which are administered by various insurance companies. Now, this portability or transfer facility is also provided to superannuation funds. The steps are, as a requirement, you need to have a Tier 1 account. I have told you what is Tier 1 and Tier 2 account. And you need to make a request through the employer to recognized provident fund or approved superannuation trust for transfer. And after this, after receipt of the request, the recognized provident fund or approved superannuation fund trust will initiate the transfer and issue the check or draft in the name of POP collection account, NPS trust, subscriber name and BRA. This POP is nothing but point of presence agencies. These are intermediaries between the subscriber and the trustee bank, and they will collect the documentation, they will also collect the funds and contribute to the Tier 1 pension account. And the PRAN is nothing but it is a permanent retirement account number. It is like, you know, if you are an EPF member, you have a UAN number, universal account number. And if you are an income tax SSC, you have a permanent account number. So PRAN is also something like that. And the employee is also required to request a letter from the recognized PF or SAF trust to the employer and POP mentioning what is the amount being transferred and credited to the NPS Tier 1 account of the employee. What happens after this stage is the POP or the point of presence will collect the fund and credit it to the NPS Tier 1 account of the employee. So by doing this, the process gets completed. Before we get into whether you can transfer employees provident fund accumulations to national pension system or the pension scheme, we have to be aware certain basic information about NPS versus EPF. What are the benefits under NPS? What are the benefits under EPF? What is the tax treatment? If we know all this information, then it is easy for us to decide whether to port or not and when it is possible. Now, if we are talking about investment and returns between these two schemes, so in NPS, what happens is you have the option to decide how your fund should get invested, either in equity or corporate debt and government securities. So you have the option. You can also change this ratio or percentage of allocation on a yearly basis or a periodic basis. However, the NPS does not offer any guarantee on the returns because the returns depends on the performance of the fund. However, based on the market performance, the returns will vary. So now we talked about NPS investment and returns. Let's look into how the EPF behaves. See, EPF, in case of EPF, the EPFO decides the investment pattern of your fund, and then majorly the EPFO invests your fund into government securities, bonds, debts and security, etc. And also it declares annual interest on the accumulation. So far, the interest on your PF accumulation has been in the range of 8 to 8.5%. And in the previous years, it was more also. And recently, it is in the range of 8 to 8.5% interest. So now let's look into what is a tax treatment at the contribution stage. Let's also compare what is NPS talks about it and what is EPF talks about it. In the NPS, you can have both kind of contributions, like, you know, employer contribution and employee contribution as well as in the EPF. Employer contribution up to 10% of basic and DA is non-taxable under Section 80CCD of Income Tax Act. And employee's contribution to NPS is included as an exemption within the overall ceiling of rupees 1.5 lakhs under Section 80CCD. So if you look at today's taxation, you have two regimes, whereas the old regime and the new regime. In the old regime, you can get exemption of for investments, whereas in the new regime, it is not possible. But if you choose to continue with the old regime, and this is possible. And for an employee, an additional deduction for investment up to rupees 50,000 in NPS, that is in Tier 1 account, is available exclusively to NPS subscribers under Section 80CCD 1B of the Income Tax Act 1961. And this is over and above the deduction of rupees 1.5 lakhs available under Section 80C of Income Tax Act 1961. And what is the benefit for employers? Whereas employees provident fund is a statutory contribution and NPS is not a statutory contribution, what is the benefit for employers? See, the benefit for employers is the contribution made towards NPS up to 10% of basic and DA can be deducted as a business expense from their profit and loss account. So this is the benefit for employers. Now let's compare the EPF with related to tax treatment and the contribution stage. Employees' contribution to EPS is included as an exemption within the overall ceiling of rupees 1.5 lakhs under Section 80CCE. And the employer contribution to PF not exceeding 12% is not taxed. If the contribution are more than 12%, again, this is subject to the tax liability. And the interest credited on this 12% is also not taxable. There is a change in the income tax laws, especially in the year 2020-21. It talks about employer's contribution towards NPS, EPF, and superannuation fund in excess of 7.5 lakhs in a year. And also the interest earned on the excess contribution is taxable in the hands of employees. So this change brought in the year 2020-21. And let's look into what is the change. If you look at Section 17 of the Income Tax Act 1961, it talks about what is salary and perquisite, which qualifies as taxable income. And 17.2 basically talks about perquisites. So 17.2.7 of the Income Tax Act 1961 originally read like this: the amount of any contribution to an approved superannuation fund by the employer in respect of the assessee to the extent it exceeds 1 lakh rupees. And it was only limited to superannuation fund. Now, by way of Finance Act 2020, the amendment was brought to Income Tax Act 1961. The amendment is, now this talks about the total amendment, Section 17.2.7 of the Act. It talks about the aggregate of amounts of any contribution made to Provident Fund or the NPS or the superannuation fund to the extent it exceeds 7,50,000 rupees in a previous year, that is whatever exceeds 7.5 lakhs, it is subject to taxability. And also the interest earned on this excess contribution is also taxable. However, if you look at this amendment, friends, this is not effective today because the effective date is first day of April 2021. For the year, financial year 2020 and 21, this possibility or this provision is not applicable. Now, let's talk about tax treatment during the withdrawal stage. So, in the previous slide, what happened? At the contribution stage, what is the taxability? We talked about it. And now we will talk about what is the tax treatment during withdrawal stage, because it is also for you, it is important. When you contribute, whether you pay tax or not. When you withdraw, you also pay tax or not. So, you see, both possibilities we need to understand to exercise our option. So, in case of NPS, an employee who is 60 years or older can withdraw maximum 60% of the fund balance in lump sum, and the rest of the fund goes to annuity plan for monthly pension. And NPS withdrawal is tax free only up to 60% of the total amount. The prior to 1st April 2020, it was 40%. So now it is 60%. And the NPS also gives the possibility of early exit. In such case, only 25% of the withdrawal amount is only tax free. And amount invested in purchase of annuity is fully exempt from tax. However, the income you get out of annuity in the subsequent year will be subject to income tax. So we talked about NPS. Now let's talk about EPF. In EPF, what happens? See, employees who do not take up any other employment within 2 months after the separation of employment or termination of employment, entire PF balance can be withdrawn in lump sum. However, if the EPF balance is withdrawn before the completion of 5 years, then withdrawal of provident fund accumulations is taxed. So this taxability or this withdrawal is because of his ill health, or the employer has discontinued his business, or other reason beyond his control, is not taxable. And when the provident fund accumulations becomes taxable and the accumulation is more than rupees 50,000, and the PF department will deduct the TDS and pay the rest of you. However, there is a possibility also if you give form G or H, whatever the case, depending on the applicability of this form, then the provident fund department will not deduct the TDS. So we have looked into certain information about NPS and EPF, and we have compared which one is what and what is best and what is not. And now we have to talk about it, whether your EPF accumulation, is it possible to transfer to national pension system? And is this implemented in case of employees provident fund? So now we will deliberate about this topic. See, if you look at employees provident fund and miscellaneous provisions Act 1952 and the schemes framed under this statute, the reasons of withdrawal or transfer of EPF balance is regulated as per these provisions. And the scheme framed and the withdrawals are subject to the provisions of EPF and Miscellaneous Provisions Act 1952, and in specific Section 5, 6A and 6C read with Schedule 2, 3. For what reasons withdrawal and transfers can be made are detailed in their respective schemes. provisions in chapter 8 of the EPF scheme 1952 provides option for withdrawal from the provident fund. However, if you look at these reasons or provisions, these do not provide for transfer to NPS account. And if you look at the EPS scheme 1995, the current system, it also, you know, does not give any option to transfer the accumulation to any other fund like NPS. And moreover, the moment the EPF is transferred to NPS or NPS is opted in lieu of EPF or EPS, it can also be taken as exit from Employees Deposit Linked Insurance Scheme and Employees Pension Scheme. So therefore, there is still a lot more clarity is required on this. And as long as these are not addressed and the law is not amended, there is no chance to transfer the EPF to NPS or exercising the option of NPS in lieu of EPS. So there are no amendments have been taken care of so far. Therefore, you do not have a possibility to transfer the EPF accumulations to NPS or exercising the option of NPS in lieu of EPS. And moreover, the NPS is very new and EPF has been the safest savings for difficult times and for retirement. But however, the NPS, employees who are looking for additional tax benefits and saving options, this is a very good option. And people who are not covered under employees pension scheme or EPF provisions, the NPS is a good option because it takes care of your the fund requirement in the retirement. So this is a safety precaution for all other employees. So we talked about as long as the amendment to EPF and Miscellaneous Provisions Act does not happen, there is no possibility to transfer your employees provident fund to NPS. But is there a possibility to transfer your other funds like your superannuation fund or provident fund like PPF? The answer to this question is yes, there is a possibility. If you have a superannuation fund, you are contributing, you have a possibility to transfer that accumulations to NPS fund. Even your public provident fund accumulation also can be transferred to NPS because the PFRDA has already clarified this topic and also laid out certain steps. I also had a talk to certain few superannuation fund managers. They have also confirmed that it is possible. And to do that, if you have a superannuation fund, you will have a trust, and the trust rule, you will have to incorporate this provision to transfer the superannuation fund to NPS provision. So this is still possible for in case of superannuation fund and other provident fund like PPF. Thank you very much, friends. So far, we talked about the portability of EPF to NPS, and also whether it is possible to exercise the option of NPS in lieu of EPS, and we talked about various other details. Thank you very much, friends, for watching my video. Thank you very much, friends, for watching this video. If you like this effort and if you like this information, please do share, like, and comment in the channel. And if you have not subscribed, please do subscribe this channel for more updates on labor law and labor relations and also industry news. Thank you very much and stay connected. See you soon, friends.